It's now time for Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. It began as a podcast, went live on the net, and transformed into a full-blown empire. Across the web, on Fight Now TV, and on radio stations around the world. It's the only daily boxing talk radio show on the planet, hosted by the only guy with the balls to do it. Many have stepped into the ring. Many have tried to take the belt. And one by one, they've fallen. Another victim of the undisputed heavyweight champion of boxing talk radio. Talkin' Boxing with Billy C is on now.
My style is impetuous. My defense is impregnable. And I'm just ferocious. I want your heart.
We're coming to you live from the Billy C studio in Lake George, New York. I'm Bill Caligero, and it's time for Talking Boxing with Billy C. Good morning, good day, good evening. Whenever you listen, I hope you're doing all right. We got a busy, busy show scheduled for you today. Plus, don't forget, we're going to actually go a little longer today to accommodate my main man, Marty Mulcahy. So we will be going beyond 7 p.m. If you're watching live. So make sure you stick around. If you're watching a replay, don't worry about it. It'll just end when it ends. Hey, don't forget this show is being brought to you in part by Camp and Aaron Tomkovich. If you're looking for a lawyer, use the ones that keep my ass out of trouble. That's Camp and Aaron Tomkovich. Give them a call today, 845-221-4099. 845-221-4099. Let Camp and Aaron Tomkovich knock out your legal problem. 845-221-4099. The show is also being brought to you in part by The Gentleman Boxer. That's right. It's a great story of a fighter named Joe Grimm and other great fighters of his era, the Roaring Twenties. This is a must-read for any boxing fan, whether it's a diehard fan or whether you're just starting out, man. This is what it's all about. I got a call today from one of our writers, Austin Killeen. He says, "Hey, I need a book to read. I need something good." You know, I said, "This is the one, man, Gentleman Boxer." Gave out our first Billy C. Boxing Book Club of the Year Award, and this guy got it. Get yourself a copy right now. Visit the website, www.iangrumeza.com. That's I-O-N-G-R-U-M-E-Z-A.com. If you like signed copies, make sure you drop me an email, billy@talkinboxing. That's T-A-L-K-I-N-B-O-X-I-N-G.com, and I'll hook you up with a signed copy. And the show's also being brought to you in part by the Titty Grab Game. Check out the website, www.tittygrab.com. We got a lot of stuff going on. Dax Khan is scheduled to join us a little bit later with his boxing schedule roundup. We got some fight results that took place today, last night, which was basically tomorrow, which was today. I don't know. I get confused. From the land down under, we got the fight results that took place tonight, which was actually 12, 15 hours ago, so we'll talk about that. Some fights that we added to the Billy C. Challenge. We'll chat about that. Some promotional confusion going on in C-Town, Chicago, or Chi-Town, I guess, or Chi-Town, or whatever they call it. We'll talk about that. Daniel Ponce León, he's returning to the ring. We'll talk about that. What's not happening is that World Cup of Boxing, I'll tell you why they're holding off on that. Sergio Martinez got some time with Pope Francis today. Not as much as I think he wanted, but he had some time. Couple of quotes. We never got into the Zab Judah Paulie Malignaggi quotes, so I got those. Plus, I got Bernard Hopkins and Karo Murat's quotes from their press conference. I'm going to take a look at the Danny O'Connor fight that took place in Pennsylvania. He lost to Vivian Harris, and they're crying more than one Manu Marquez. So we'll talk about that. Also, some comments from Ricky Hatton concerning Amir Khan and Floyd Mayweather, which are pretty comical. I'm wondering if he's back on the on some controlled substances or something, because he's not making any sense. But anyway, we'll talk about that in a little bit. We're going to open up the phone lines a little later, so if you have some thoughts, comments, or concerns, make sure you Check that out. And tomorrow, I'm going to give you guys my review of the ESPN No Mas. I don't know if anybody caught that documentary the other night, but I'm going to talk about that tomorrow on tomorrow's show. Give you my thoughts on that, whether you should watch it. The guy who did it for ESPN was actually the same guy that did the Resto. You know, the movie about Louis Resto with the Billy Collins Jr. and all of that. The guy Drake, he's the same one that did that. So I'll give you my review about that tomorrow. So make sure you get ready for that. First thing I want to do is, yesterday we got a really good email from Yield to Fear. Problem is, I didn't get a chance to really get into it until the end of the show. We got all involved with the Joe Louis thing, which incidentally, we don't have enough time to talk about Joe Louis. I think the heavyweight spotlight will be coming back, and we're going to be dedicating a whole hour on Joe Louis. So make sure you look for that coming up in the near future. But as a matter of fact, we're going to be doing another roundtable fairly soon. And I had a different topic I wanted to talk about, but maybe we'll talk about Joe Louis. Anyway, this email from Yield to Fear was talking about, he says, hey, Billy C, the fights from this weekend were great. I felt Bradley won against Marquez. It was cool seeing him implement some of the same tactics as Mayweather and similarly outboxing Marquez. Style makes fights. The undercard wasn't bad at all. Cruz versus Alito was a decent matchup. Lomachenko was entertaining. He says, do you think Top Rank is focusing on collecting talent from overseas? It seems like they're trying really hard to expand beyond the U.S. In many different ways. Also, can you explain how boxing works in relation to the networks and promotional companies, like how do Pacquiao and Mayweather or any boxer get paid? Does the promoter pay for everything with the network and pay the boxers, etc.? Who cuts the checks? Please take some time to explain this. First and foremost, I know I touched on it yesterday, but I'll touch on it again. My opinion of Top Rank and the overseas stuff is that, you know, he's expanding markets. I say he, meaning Bob Arum. I think what's happening with that is he sees that there's huge interest in, like, for example, China. The Manny Pacquiao fight's going to be in China. And, you know, they're going where the money is. You know, they're gonna air the fight here in the States. But once you've got, venues and networks and stuff willing to throw money at you, and then you have the interest in the fans who are coming to buy tickets, and you have a pool of fighters, all of that equals, let's go to that country. You know, a lot of fighters want to come over here in the States because of some TV exposure opportunities that we have here. But make no mistake, countries like England, up until this year, I was saying this a lot, England and Canada, but Canada's been dormant this year. I mean, what a slow boxing year. If it wasn't for Adonis Stevenson, really, we wouldn't have as many fights as what we had leading up to this year. But generally, over the last half a dozen years or so, I think England and Canada have been pretty much carrying boxing on its back, although the U.S. is coming through now, and the U.S. has some of the bigger fights all the time. But the fights that happen in, I mean, you go to England, you know, they got fights every single weekend. They got double-digit amount of fights going on all throughout the country, you know. And, we don't really have that as much. But this year was a banner year for us here in the States. So, we're just enjoying it. Now, as far as the business of boxing goes, like I was saying yesterday, basically the promoter's cutting the checks. Now, how he gets his revenue, of course, promoters get their revenue from ticket sales. They also get their revenue from television deals. The TV network will pay that promoter. And then, of course, sponsorships. So what typically will happen is that the promoter will cut a deal with the fighters. He offers them X amount of purse or whatever. And if it's a big fight, you know, he'll go and try and get TV or possibly get the TV. A smart promoter will get that TV interest first, and then go and make the fights. And then by the end of the night, the bottom line is the promoter's cutting all the checks for everybody, not the networks. The networks own the video. They own the broadcast. But you know, that's that. So that was a really great question. From yield to fear, I know we talked about it yesterday. I just wanted to make sure we closed on that today. You know, as we kicked off the show, so it was. I love those kinds of questions, and I appreciate it from yield to fear. One last thing before I take a break, Hawaii Mike, Hawaii Mike, the bet. I've had forgotten about the bet. He says the bet BC is Fury and Hay. You've got the stiff idiot Fury. I've got Hay. If I win, which I will, because Fury can't box for beans, I'll say, he says, you need to be paying for me to come to New York, and then I'll be paying and then paying for all my drinks. Capisce? Hey, first of all, what are you talking about, Hawaii Mike? You said that, and I still have the email, you said that in your email to me, you said, if Tyson Fury beats David Hay, you're coming to Hawaii on me. I'm serious. No kidding. All expenses paid. That's what you said. All right. So never once did I have to bring you. I'm not rich like you, Hawaii Mike. I can't bring you over here. If I could bring you over here, I'd be flying over there. You know, so but I'd be willing to do something else. I don't know. But yeah, I'll be getting ready to go to Hawaii because I think that if David Hay is man enough to get in the ring with Tyson Fury, I have this strange feeling Tyson Fury is going to beat him. We'll be right back.
If you're in upstate New York and you need a trucking company, then you need Roselli Enterprises. Roselli Enterprises is trucking at its finest. They have it all. Dump trucks, dump trailers, walk-in floors, flatbeds, flow boys, tankers, loaders, and a full line of roll-off containers for any job, big or small. Roselli Enterprises is also the source for all your sand, gravel, and topsoil needs. Visit them on the web at RoselliTrucking.com or call 315-433-5115. That's 315-433-5115 and tell them Billy C sent you.
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights, all the names, all the action. From world-class boxing events to mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups, Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV. For more details, go to fightnow.com.
We've got a great matchup tonight. Fighting out of the left corner is the number one ranked contender.
No, he is not.
I'm sorry, but who are you?
I am the IBO computer. I am programmed to provide only fair and unbiased boxing rankings. This fighter is the number 15 ranked contender.
Fair and unbiased boxing rankings? That's a new concept.
Actually, it is not. The IBO has provided unbiased computerized rankings for many years.
Well, we've still got a great fight tonight, folks. In the left corner is the number 15 ranked contender.
The IBO, the champion of integrity. Learn more at IBOboxing.com.
Check out BillyCBoxing.com now, or feel the wrath of the mighty mustache.
Oh, that hurts! Why are you doing that to my face? I hate you. I hate you.
That's BillyCBoxing.com. Consider this your warning.
As a young boy, all Billy C dreamed about was one day having his own catchphrase.
And we're back. And we're back.
One boy, one dream, one day, everyone will say.
And we're back. 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 And we're back.
Catchphrase, coming soon to a theater near you.
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C Show. Glad you could join us. Don't forget to check out the website, man, www.billycboxing.com. You know, we update that thing at least a dozen times a day, and you can check it out. It's a lot more than just the front page. You got to look at the other sections on the site, and of course, visit all the banners, all of our people that are involved with us. We highly recommend that you do business with them. You know what I mean? Here's Mickey. That's right. We got another email from my drunken Irish buddy. And he says, "Our Billy C. 'Twas having a wee grand time back in me pub last night. No bother at all. The drinks were flying until the Mexican wanker who got me banned came in. I said, 'You listen here, Horse Bradley beat juicing bastard.'" He says, he goes, "Come outside." He says, "Come outside, S.A." He says, "I'll show you a real Mexicano how he gets down, fool." I say, "Go feck yourself, you wee midget, and show me your green card while you're at it." Billy C., that really pissed off the bastard. The laddie flipped the wee table and threw a stool across the bar. The bouncers grabbed him and carried him to the curb. Another Mexican laddie come up to me 20 minutes later, and we got into an argument over Ireland versus Mexico. This wanker was a good 200 pounds bigger than me, so I kept my cool, Billy C. I was a good 25 Bud Lights into the night. Bud Lights? What is this? Now I'm wondering if Mickey's really Irish, Bud Light. What kind of Mick drinks Irish? What kind of Irish Mick drinks Bud Lights? Come on, man. You should be drinking some heavy stout. You got to be chewing your beer. Now I don't even know if you're really Irish, Mickey. Come on, man. Come on. Anyway, he says he had 25 Bud Lights into him. So he says, "Listen here, Mr. Mexico. If me mate Shawnee Monahan fights Julio Chavez Jr. at 175, I'll bet you $500 he wins. Shawnee's better than Vera, in my opinion. Billy C., I was a bit rode off in the high heavens last night when I made the bet. When I woke up this morning, I was wondering if it was a smart bet. Give me your thoughts. Cheers." My thoughts are you better quit drinking, my man. Otherwise, you're going to be living in the streets. That's a stupid bet. Stupid, stupid bet, Mickey. Come on, man. Shawnee Monahan may be Irish, but he's a bum. And you know, Chavez would beat him every step of the way. Shawnee Monahan is a guy that just has been coddled, hasn't fought anybody yet, really doesn't show any. I mean, you watched the fight on Saturday. He didn't show us anything. He was fighting another guy that looked great on paper, but he looked like the Pillsbury Doughboy. That guy was in just as bad a shape as I was, Shawnee Monahan's opponent. Come on, man. Come on. No, man, you made a big mistake. If I were you, I'd change pubs because you're going to lose that nickel. I'll tell you that right now. You're going to lose that nickel for sure. But anyway, we got some other emails. Navos2003 says, "Bradley needs to start getting the respect he deserves. He's never got it. Hopefully now people will see he's a great fighter. He deserves a shot at Floyd. He has the speed and athletic abilities to give Floyd trouble. He can make adjustments in the ring and is mentally as tough as they come." I agree with you about him not getting his props, because I've been saying that a lot. For some reason, I don't know why he's not a bigger star than he is. I mean, he's everything we want in our heavyweight champions, in our world champions. This guy's a great role model. He's always in shape. He tries his hardest. He fights anybody they put in front of him. He's gotten better. He improves. He's not the same robotic fighter that we see. Mentally strong, yes, he is. As far as giving Floyd trouble, yeah, you know, I mean, he's a young fighter. He's athletic. You know, he's got some pop. He's not going to be afraid of Floyd. I think he's got pop. People keep saying he's got no punching power. I think he's got some pop. He's clearly gotten some fighters in trouble. He just doesn't have the one-punch knockout power. But here's his weakness that Floyd... I agree with you, Navos. I want to see the fight. Not that we will because of the feud between the promoters and also Mayweather and Top Rank. But here's the thing. The one mistake that I think that he makes is that he is a fighter that... you know, when somebody engages with him or wants to engage, he obliges.
even though he's got the boxing ability. Now, with that said, I think the fight that he fought with Prodognikov would actually be the game plan to take on Floyd. You're not going to outbox Floyd, at least Timothy Bradley's not. And Timothy Bradley has a tendency when he gets into exchanges to really leave his head open when he's not using it to punch. You know, he's drops his hands and lets his hands go, but no protection up top. I think Floyd would have the counterpunching ability to pick him apart. But like you, I'd like to see the fight. I think he deserves it, and I'd rather see that than Amir Khan. That's for sure. Thanks for the email, Navos2003. Sovereign, my man Sovereign says, I agree that Zab Judah, Paulie Malignaggi, I can't get excited for that. Nothing on the line, no belts. It's not even a grudge match. They're friends, but I'll probably watch it. You know, that's not why. I guess I was wrong. You know what? I was wrong yesterday, and I'll tell you why. I'm not interested in the fight. I'm not interested in the fight, per se. But I did use that line. There's nothing on the line. What did they accomplish? Blah, blah, blah. And really, that's where I made a mistake, and I apologize for that. Because I don't want people to only watch boxing if there's something on the line. And with that said, I think you got two guys similar in the position of their career, you know, towards the end. And, you know, they're looking to get a win against each other, and then hope that some doors open up. Which doors they will be, I don't know. But with that said, I'm glad that they're fighting. It's just that it's not an interesting fight for me. That's all I'm saying. You know, I'm not a big fan of either one, and I don't think that they're going to sell all that many. Listen, Zab Judah couldn't sell anything in Brooklyn. You know, unless he's selling drugs. You know, if he's selling drugs, he'll do all right. But, you know, he can't sell tickets, man. Paulie, I don't know. Sovereign goes on to say, Marquez is such a crybaby. Compare his spitting his dummy out and endless whining to Pac's conduct. Pacquiao smiled, shrugged his shoulders, and quickly made his point and moved on. That's being a man. I don't get compare his spitting with his dummy. Compare his spitting his dummy out. I don't get that. But anyway, I understand your point. He says Pacquiao's a man. I wouldn't mind it so much, but Marquez wasn't even robbed. He lost a competitive fight. Big deal. Pac's going to beat Seven Shades out of Rios. I don't know, man. You know, listen. You know, one of the my big issues, and the reason why I prefer watching Manny Pacquiao fights, isn't that I love Manny Pacquiao because I don't, but he does test himself, he does challenge himself a lot more than other so-called pound for pound fighters, and I think the Bam Bam Rios fight is a good example. You know, Manny Pacquiao is coming off of a devastating knockout loss to Juan Manuel Marquez. I don't care if he got knocked out by, you know, the cleaning lady. You know, anybody that gets knocked out like that and then comes back and fights another type of a fighter like Bam Bam Rios, that's taking a chance. You know, Manny Pacquiao is taking a chance of being knocked out again, regardless of whether you think Bam Bam Rios is, you know, that high of a caliber fighter or not. You know, it's just the style. So I give him credit. And, you know, when you're in a phone booth, when you're fighting in a phone booth like that, you know, anybody can land a good shot. And if Manny Pacquiao is a little on the weak side from that knockout loss, and Bam Bam Rios, you know, collectively, you know, puts on, you know, a barrage of punches that land, you might see Manny Pacquiao hitting the canvas again. So, well, I think it's an interesting fight, and I'm not so sure that Pacquiao is going to have his way with Bam Bam Rios. You know, Rios is a guy that a lot of his game is mental, and he knows that he'll have, you know, a lot of opportunities if he beats Manny Pacquiao. Now, the only thing going against Bam Bam Rios is that he was in such awe of being in China when they did the press conference and the press tour. Hopefully, that will leave him, and he'll be able to focus. Because if he's just like looking around like he's a tourist in New York City, Manny Pacquiao will have his way. We got some more emails. I got several more I'm going to read. We got the fight results from Australia. I'll tell you about that. We got some promotional confusion going on in Chicago. We got the other Chavez fighting Friday. We'll talk about that. I got an update on Daniel Ponce de Leon. Sergio Martinez met the Pope. We'll talk about that. We got quotes from Paulie Malignaggi and Zab Judah, as well as Bernard Hopkins and Karo Murat. And I was just informed by my man Dax Khan, when he comes on to do his boxing schedule roundup at the top of the hour, he's got some quotes as well from Canada. So all of that stuff is going to be happening in 2 minutes.
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights, all the names, all the action. From world-class boxing events to mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups, Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV. For more details, go to fightnow.com.
Broadcasting in all corners of the globe,
on the web
and radio.
He would scoff at a stretcher, that man, I would think.
You're listening to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. From upstate New York and the good old US of A.
Boxing is here to stay because we are here to stay.
The best 2 hours of boxing talk on the airwaves.
Hey, fight fans, check out KOFantasyBoxing.com. KOFantasyBoxing is boxing's only trademarked fantasy game. Check it out, www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. Select your own gym, your own fighters, track them through a season that can last from 3 months to a year, depending upon which league you join. You got to check this out, man. www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. Join it today. Again, www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. And tell him Billy C sent ya.
Now back to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C, the only radio host man enough to take a punch from Mike Tyson.
Wait a minute, man. Hold on there. Jeremy, man, I need you to take this one, all right?
Wait, what? No way. I can't do this.
Need I remind you I'm Billy C, damn it? Now put on that mustache and get in there.
Hey, look at me. I'm Billy C. Crap.
The undisputed heavyweight champion of boxing talk radio. It's Talkin' Boxing with Billy C.
Test 1, 2. My fellow Americans, good evening. Welcome back to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. It's great to be here discussing the sweet science with everybody. I love boxing. I love talking boxing. It's what I do.
Bill.
Wait, what? Why are you interrupting me? What?
Wrong.
What's
wrong,
the problem?
Billy, what? See?
I did not have...
We're gonna have to ask
wrong
you.
Wrong speech. What do you mean wrong, Billy C? What's going on here? Fine, I'll go. I just wanted to talk some boxing on TPSradio.net. That's all I wanted to do. I don't need your damn show. I'll get my own talking wrestling with the other Billy C. Yeah, that sounds good. Yeah. I've always been a Hulkamaniac anyway.
Broadcasting live, brother. Welcome back to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C on the mighty TPSradio.net, brother. What you gonna do, brother?
And we're back. You're listening to the Talkin' Boxing with Billy C show. And you're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. Glad you could join us. And if you don't have Fight Now on your sports channel lineup, you need to call your local television provider and tell them that you want Fight Now right now. It's that simple. Pick up the phone and call. Only information about the channel can be found on their website, www.fightnow.com. My man Chatty You know, he says that the food is better on the East Coast. He's out on the West Coast. Definitely better on the East Coast, but not in Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania's the worst for food. Anyway, you know, I think, you know, it's I've eaten there several times when I drive through. It's a tough state to drive through. It's a tough state to drive through. But New York, definitely great food in New York. And out west, if you go to Vegas, Vegas has some great food, too. Florida's not bad. Florida's not bad. But to tell you the truth, and I'm not saying this just because I live in New York, but from all the places, I mean, outside, you know, you go to Europe and you're going to get some great food. But I think Chatty's right. You know, the East Coast is better. California has a lot of weird stuff, although I would like a lot of it because I like, you know, Mexican type food. And I heard there's a lot of choices out there. But anyway, enough about my food show here. But Hawks is, I think Paulie versus Zab is a good matchup. Both guys have names and are solid B-level guys from New York. I'm surprised they haven't fought sooner. They may set a record throwing jabs. However, Zab did say that if he beats Paulie, it puts him in the Mayweather sweepstakes. I'm not interested in that fight. Why? Why? What is beating Paulie Malignaggi? How does Zab Judah? You see, Zab Judah actually made a statement the last time he had a mic in front of his stupid face was that he was a pound-for-pound top fighter. That's what he said. You know, maybe at one time, but not now. And let me ask you something. What is a win over Paulie Malignaggi, who you know, just lost? You know, how does a win over him set up a fight with Mayweather? I mean, come on, man. Listen. If Mayweather fights guys like Zab Judah, you know, I'm going to be more critical than I ever was. I'd rather not see him fight anymore. I'd rather see him walk away now and have his undefeated record intact and everything else. He doesn't have to fight Zab Judah. Zab Judah? You know, Paulie Malignaggi? I mean, they're really the only two names in the welterweight division. And Zab Judah's not even in the welterweight division. He's moving up for the fight. The only two names in the welterweight division that have any kind of bite to them that would even interest me a little. And I'm not saying that they even would beat Floyd, but Manny Pacquiao and Timothy Bradley are the only two. They're the only two. You know, I don't want to see Amir Khan. That's a joke. Amir Khan shouldn't even get a chance to fight Floyd. Floyd isn't. Amir hasn't even fought in the welterweight division yet either. Danny Garcia, you know, at one point, you know, I'll be honest. I wanted to see Floyd fight Danny Garcia before Floyd fought Canelo Alvarez. Now, you know, Floyd's too big for Danny Garcia. You know, so listen, Floyd has nobody left in the junior middleweight division. He's got nobody of note in the welterweight division except two fighters he won't fight. So come on, man. Are we really going to have to just be waiting? I tell you what, right now, if Floyd Mayweather fights Zab Judah, or if Floyd Mayweather fights Paulie Malignaggi, or if Floyd Mayweather fights Amir Khan, unless it's in London, I think he's going to do poorly with the pay-per-view buys. Listen, I don't like him, but I have a feeling he's going to announce a fight that we're going to like. That's all I'm going to say. I don't know who it's going to be, but I have a feeling that Floyd is very proficient at finding fighters that at least appear to be interesting, like the Canelo Alvarez fight. We all knew that he was going to beat Canelo, but a lot of media people thought that it was a close fight. All the Mexicans thought it was going to be a close fight. Floyd's going to get that kind of opponent. He's going to find an opponent that people think have a chance against Floyd, and really, he won't. So, but nobody thinks that Amir Khan or Zab Judah or Paulie Malignaggi, none of those guys have a chance. So we'll see what happens. But anyway, Hawk goes on to say, however, Zab did say that, I already read that. He says, it's sad. He said, Hawk finishes his thought by saying, it's sad the way the IRS treated Joe Louis, but the IRS has no heart. So many wealthy boxers wind up being broke. It's sad. They need good financial advisors and tax attorneys. but they must find some that won't rob them blind. Well, that's the problem. See, listen, our government is a bunch of bullies. Our government is a bunch of bullies. You know, and the IRS is, they're worse than a loan shark. They're worse than a loan shark. All of the interest and everything else. Now, with that said, you know, you could, if you work for the government or you work for the IRS, you could turn around and say, well, you know, this is a guy that's not paying their taxes. They're not paying their taxes, so, you know, we got to do what we got to do to collect the money. That's what they're going to say, you know. So, you know, if it's somebody that's, you know, not paying taxes on purpose, I mean, how many times do we hear all these rich, rich people not paying taxes, you know, fine. You know, but what bothers me the most is, like all bullies, the IRS goes and beats up on the ones that can't defend themselves. The poverty stricken guy who owes $300 to the IRS, you know, that's the guy that the IRS is going to go and seize his bank account with $50 in it and take his car and all of that stuff. That's who the government will pick on. They'll prey on that because they're scumbags. All right, I can't stand them. All right, and then what they did to Joe Lewis was even worse. Joe Lewis, he donated his purse, you know, and the government still taxed him. You realize that, right? Let's just say, I mean, I don't know how many thousands of dollars he made for those fights, but let's say he makes $1,000, right? $1,000. And he says, okay, my purse, I'm getting paid $1,000. I'm donating it to the war effort. And then the government says, well, the tax on that $1,000 is, you know, whatever, $100. So you owe us that. You know, so what? They really expected Joe Lewis to reach in his pocket and pull out $100, and I'm just using, I'm making these numbers up, pull out $100 from his own money and pay. I mean, it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous, and it is sad. And what makes it even worse is that they did it, they were just so uncool about it. You know, that's our government for you. You know, love it. Anyway. Was that the... Is that the police at the door? I think the IRS is at the door. Gift Media says, Billy, I think people do care about the Judah Malignaggi fight. This is a prime example of when the market counts more than skills, and it's a part of boxing, too. I think it's a wonderful event for Brooklyn. Did you see them Brooklyn Nets jerseys with each fighter's respective hoods printed on the back? Yeah, I did. I'm a Nets fan, so yeah. He says, I almost had a Brooklyn overdose when I saw that. All that remains is for Jay-Z to be the announcer instead of Jimmy Lennon Jr. and Spike Lee to give us the camera angles during the fight. You know, my point is, it's not, I'm not saying it's not good for Brooklyn. You know, the Brooklyn, the Barclays Center has been doing very well. I mean, quite honestly, I mean, and I've gotten people telling me that are down in the city, nothing's being promoted. I don't know how they're selling all the tickets. They don't even promote it, you know. So, and they've been putting on some terrible cards. So I don't know. Not the HBO and above cards. I'm talking about the Monday Night Fight Series. But my point about those two is they, throughout their whole careers, they have both said, put a fight in New York, I'll sell tickets. Put a fight in Brooklyn. Oh, they love me in Brooklyn. That's Zab Judah. You know, when Zab Judah, what was the last fight? His last fight that he had, he's going, he lost the fight, and they're going, you want to fight again? He says, oh, well, Brooklyn, you want me? You want me, Brooklyn? And you heard like one person. You know, it's like, oh, yeah, they want me. They want me. They all left, Zab. They didn't come here for you, man. You know, now maybe Paulie's a more likable guy and he'll draw. Listen, I'm not saying anything negative about the location of the fight or anything like that. I'm just saying the two fighters, you know. And like I said, I look at it differently today than I did yesterday. I'm not interested in the fight, but it's a good fight. It's two evenly matched fighters. Going at it. They're at the same stage in their career. They both are similar in skills. And, God bless them both. Gift goes on to say, Billy C, what's your beef with Tarver? Yes, he ended up peaking too early and hence not so many fights on his resume. But that's a brilliant resume, losing to potentials and all-stars, but then coming back to beat them in rematches. If at first you don't succeed, then try again. And he did, and he won. as with Harding, Johnson, and, of course, Roy Jones Jr. So if all else fails and change your mind, he beat Roy Jones Jr.'s ass. Was Roy Jones Jr. 75 years when he fought him? Making fun of our thing. Well, you know, Antonio Tarver to me was never really that talented. I mean, Tarver, lost to his first loss was against Jeff Harding. I'm sorry, Eric Harding in 2000. It was an IBF title elimination bout. Then in 2001, he beat a 22-0 Lincoln Carter, which was a good win. And then he fought Chris Johnson and Reggie Johnson, got two wins over them, and set up a rematch with Eric Harding, which he avenged and won. And then you're right, he fought Montel Griffith, Montel Griffin for the title. He won that. Lost his belt in his first defense against Roy Jones Jr., had the rematch against Roy, knocked him out. Then he lost to Glenn Johnson. Then he won against Johnson. Then he beat Roy Jones again. Then he lost to Bernard Hopkins. Then he beat Elvire, Mercury, and Danny Santiago, two fighters that had good records, but they weren't very good. The Clinton Woods fights was a good win and an interesting fight. The Chad Dawson fights, both of them, were boring as hell. Back-to-back losses. The Nagy Aguilera fight was a joke. The Danny Green fight was a joke. And the Latif Coyote fight, he tested positive. You know, he's just a guy that doesn't let go. I like the job he did as a ringside analyst. I thought he did a fantastic job. I just think that this guy, people think he's better than he is because of Roy Jones Jr. You know, it just seemed like he just hung around too long, and now he's hanging around even longer. He's 44 years old. He's a former cruiserweight world champion and a light heavyweight champ. 29 wins, 6 losses, never been stopped, and he's got 20 knockouts. I don't know, man. I don't have anything against Tarver. I've met him personally a couple of times. He's a really nice guy. He knows his stuff about boxing. It's just, you know, sometimes when you listen to a guy talking about boxing and what other fighters, like Paulie Malignaggi, for example. Paulie Malignaggi is similar to Antonio Tarver and BJ Flores. You know, three guys that really know the boxing business in terms of what a fighter should be doing during the fight and everything else. Oh, he should be doing this, he should be doing that. But then when they are in the ring, they don't perform. Paulie Malignaggi, all of a sudden, everybody is putting this guy above his level. I don't think he's an elite fighter. He refers to himself as an elite fighter. Showtime is starting to refer to him as an elite fighter. He's not an elite fighter. He never was, and he never will be. You know, Antonio Tarver never was an elite fighter, never will be. You know, Zab Judah, maybe he was an elite fighter at one time. Maybe. Roy Jones Jr., definitely an elite fighter. Definitely an elite fighter at one time. I think Bernard Hopkins, he's elite in a sense. You got to give him credit for the longevity. And, I'm more interested in him now than when he was in his so-called prime. I don't know. Thanks for the email. Joel, my man Joel says, I remember you mentioning the other day about how in Australia they have boxing midweek. That's a regular occurrence there. They often have the big Australian shows in the middle of the week. Since they're about 14 hours ahead, by the time you wake up in New York Thursday morning, the show is over. I don't know if you know, but Blake Capriello won a unanimous decision over Alan Green in Australia. Is this the end of Alan Green? No one would want him on the card after missing weight 3 times in a row. Alan Green, listen, Teddy Atlas, I think, jinxed Alan Green. Remember the night it was an ESPN fight, and Alan Green had come back. He had been sick. I think he got sick. Then he came back, and he was making his fight on ESPN, and all he kept doing was looking at his feet. He was looking down. And Teddy kept saying it, you know, oh, he's looking at his feet. He's looking at his feet. He's looking at his feet. And then I started looking at his feet. I'm watching the show. Everybody's looking at his feet. You know, nobody's even looking at him. He never was the same after that fight. Never was the same. So I agree with I agree with Joel, and we'll be talking about that result here in a little bit. We got DaxCon coming up at the top of the hour. I got a couple more emails here that I'll read. All right, my man T. Bruce, what's the show without an email from T? He says, yeah, I did go and take a dump, but I was listening to the show from afar. You know, he wants me to ramble on about something, then he doesn't listen. But he says, I want to talk about Broner and Maidana. People let that Paulie fight for forget how much of an ass beating machine Broner is. They forget that they forget about that DeMarco fight in which his inside fighting was otherworldly. I think you need to stick to English. I know yesterday he was saying I'm going to invent some words, but anyway. He says he counters from all angles. He can impulsively turn a two-punch counter into a five-punch combination, then turn that into a swift flurry. Yeah, he's a little extra with his shoulder roll. He rolls like Floyd's having seizures. A little too obsessed with showing off his upper body speed, but he can fight. The thing with the Paulie fight is that Broner jumped up two weight classes, and to me, it seems like his body reacted the way it was supposed to when you do something like that. His body seemed lazy. He didn't even try to throw any combinations. He didn't even use any of his stellar head movement. I don't know about that. He doesn't go side to side. He moves front to back, but he says, in his fight with DeMarco, in which he began to catch punches on the inside, opposed to slipping them, he didn't even try to do that against Paulie. I know Paulie was giving him some movement, but still Broner didn't even attempt to use all of his tools. And all he did was walk forward using a busted up ass shoulder roll. He was very one-dimensional because that's the only thing he did. And I think it was because of the weight. Maidana has no movement, and he's flat-footed. He's wild and slow. I think Broner will be settled into the weight class by this time, and I think he'll use every defensive tool in his arsenal, every countering tool. I think he'll be countering everything on the inside, throwing his combination, slipping, sliding, etc. Marcos is tailor-made, and Broner's going to batter the crap out of the guy. Here's the thing. You might have hit it on the head about him moving up two weight classes. He probably should have stuck around the junior welterweight division. I think there's a lot of money fights in the junior welterweight division for Adrian Broner. I think that fight is in the junior welterweight division. I know Maidana moved up, but I have a feeling that they did make that fight at 140. But nonetheless, here's the thing. Don't compare DeMarco. Don't look at the DeMarco fight with Adrian Broner and use that as a gauge. Yes, I like Antonio DeMarco, and Broner looked good in that. What Paulie showed us with Adrian Broner is that if you're given a movement and you're boxing him, you know, and you have hand speed like Paulie has, he wasn't so quick to stand in that pocket. And when he tried, Paulie was out of the way, out of harm's way. You're right, T, that he's not going to get the movement from Marcos Maidana, but what he is going to get from Marcos Maidana is he's going to get a relentless fighter that has more heart than most in the sport today, who can take a punch and can deliver a punch, who gets up when he gets dropped. And, it's going to take a lot for Adrian Broner to finish him off. The thing I'm worried about for Broner is Maidana is a vicious body puncher. You say he's wild. He may appear wild because he throws his punches from wide angles when he's going for the head, but not when he goes to the body. When he goes to the body, it's a straight, no wasted movement punch. Then when he hooks to the body, he delivers a devastating body shot. And I think Broner, we're going to learn a lot about Broner. Remember, he didn't knock out Paulie Malignaggi. Now, with all credit for Paulie, Paulie's got a granite chin. But the other thing is Paulie can't hurt Broner. He did land punches on Broner. I think if Maidana does connect solid, we're going to see how solid Adrian Broner's chin is. Don't underestimate Marcos Maidana. I'm not saying that he's going to win. I'm just saying don't underestimate him. That's all I'm saying. And finally, My man Devin, I haven't heard from Devin from Bombay. He says, hey, Billy C, man, I've been on a trip to your old country, Italy. Beautiful place, even more beautiful women. I know, man. Stop making me so jealous. I wish I was there. It was, I love, well, then again, I love all women. So, but I'm definitely partial for Italians. I like Hispanic women and black women, too. Anyway, he says, a beautiful place. Haven't really had a chance to catch up with the, I haven't had a chance to catch up properly with the show for a couple of weeks. Read about Mayweather and Khan being planned. It makes me nauseous. So much for Mayweather challenging himself, huh? Looking forward to seeing Golovkin and Pacquiao return to the ring in November. I give Bradley props for beating Marquez, but I don't think Bradley will get a fight with Mayweather, nor could he challenge Money Mayweather. You know, he probably won't get to fight with Mayweather because of promotional differences. I think he brings something to the table, but I don't know if he's going to bring a win when it's all said and done. Mayweather-Khan is a Khan. You know, it's not official. I know it's up on, everybody keeps telling me, oh, it's up on BoxRec already. It's up on BoxRec. Well, you know, it has not been made official. I do know that Amir Khan was very excited last week about wanting to make an announcement, and he wasn't allowed to. I don't know if that had anything to do with it or not. Devon Alexander was excited about making an announcement last week, and he wasn't allowed to. So there's something going on with those three fighters. I don't know what the connection is. There is no challenge. Mayweather will not be challenging himself if he fights Amir Khan. The only thing that Floyd would do that would be somewhat of a challenge is he would leave the comfort of Las Vegas, because I don't think that he could justify bringing Amir Khan into Las Vegas and still get people interested in a fight. I think people would be interested in a fight if it's in England. But aside from that, I don't see it. I don't see an interest in it. I probably wouldn't even watch it. But anyway, hey, listen. I'm going to take a short break. When I come back, Dax Khan is scheduled to join us. We'll talk about his boxing schedule roundup. We got some other stuff, but before I take a quick break, we will talk about the fight that took place in from the land down under, Australia. Blake Capriello improved to 18-0 with a draw and 6 knockouts, and he also claimed the vacant International Boxing Organization light heavyweight title by winning a unanimous decision over Alan Green. The three judges scored the fight 117-111, 119-109, and 118-110. Green was not able to win the title, even if he won. He came in 5 pounds overweight. In my opinion, Alan Green, nobody should give this guy a fight again. He should go, you know, find another job, because obviously he's just not into this sport. He's not taking it seriously. He certainly didn't train. He went the distance. Apparently he was really stunned in the second round and again in the ninth round. He did have one good round, according to all the write-ups. I did not see it yet, and that was round three. But nonetheless, you know, don't pay to watch Alan Green fight again. The co-main event on that was Cesar Amistad, and Amistad improved to 25-3 with 3 draws, 15 of his wins coming by knockout when he beat Ogun Ferdinandius, who drops to 15-6 in that one. So we will keep you posted on those. Hey, listen, I'm going to take a short break. When I come back, Dax Khan is scheduled to join us with his boxing schedule roundup. I'll get his thoughts on the fights from last week and a couple of the fights that are on the challenge for this week, all coming up in 2.
Talkin' Boxing with Billy C now has official merchandise available on talkinboxing.com. T-shirts, sweatshirts, hoodies, and mugs, and yes, even undergarments. Talkin' Boxing apparel is the perfect gift for the boxing fan in your life. Log on to www.talkinboxing.com. That's TalkinBoxing.com. And place your order today.
Join us here for 2 hours as Billy and the gang do what they do best.
Every time I start talking about boxing, a white man got to pull Rocky Marciano's ass. Rocky Marciano was good, but compared to Joe Louis, Rocky Marciano ain't.
He beat Joe Louis's ass.
Joe Louis was 75 years old when he fought.
Huh? What?
We're supposed to be talking boxing.
It's Talking Boxing with Billy C.
As Billy C sits here in the multi-million dollar Talkin' Boxing Studios, sipping a fine wine before you're even out of bed, you should be thinking, damn, I wish I had a mustache like his. It's the Talkin' Boxing with Billy C show. He's Billy C, and you're not. Sucks to be you.
Now let's dig into our archives and hear a rare interview when Billy C first became the champion of boxing talk radio. Hello, Billy C. As the new champ, can we ask you a few questions?
Why, certainly.
Okay, your fans would like to know how you and your corner have successfully walloped the competition.
We're not ordinary people. We're morons.
Anything else?
I'm a victim of circumstance.
Did your success finally come when you made the show 5 days a week for 2 hours? What do you think?
I'm trying to think, but nothing happens.
Now, please tell the listeners what you've learned from making it this far.
Certainly. If at first you don't succeed, keep on sucking till you do succeed.
Great words of wisdom, Billy C. Keep up the great work as the undisputed People's Champion with your show, Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. Any last words to anyone who's listening?
This is your fault, you bonehead.
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C show. You're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. Glad you could join us. If you don't have the Fight Now channel in your sports channel lineup, you need to call your local television provider and tell them that you want Fight Now right now. It's that simple. Pick up the phone and call. All the information about the channel can be found on their website, www.fightnow.com. Speaking of now, joining us, Dax Khan. What's up, Dax?
Hey, how's everybody doing today?
Not too bad, not too bad. Why don't you kick off the boxing schedule roundup first, and then we'll talk about the fights from last week and some of the ones on the schedule for this week.
All right, not too much this week, but we have some good cards. Starting Friday at the Doubletree Hotel in Ontario, California, Thompson Boxing Promotions is going to have a super bantamweight. Christopher Martin taking on Enrique Quevedo in the main event on that card. On the undercard, undefeated bantamweight prospect and hard-hitting Carlos Carlson is also going to be in action. Saturday, October 19th in Santo Domingo, Dominican Republic, Manguda Promotions and Samson Boxing team up for a women's IBF female featherweight world title headliner when Denia Santana lays her belt on the line. In undercard action, Katie Wilson-Castillo, the current IBF female super bantamweight champion and former WBA female super featherweight champion Marilyn Hernandez, is also going to be in action. And in separate bouts, undefeated prospect super featherweight Javier Fortuna and KO artist bantamweight Jonathan Guzman will be in action. In Germany, ULF Steinfurth has a good card to be broadcast on Germany SAT1 TV. WBO super middleweight champion Robert Stiglitz lays his belt down against formidable but little-known Isaac Ekpo in the main event. And on the undercard, Manuel Char and Dennis Bakhtov meet for Char's plethora of regional heavyweight titles. Former IBF welterweight title holder Jan Zevic makes his return to the ring. He's set to face Sebastian Elias. In Mexico, Cancun ABD and Golden Boy co-promote this week's Fox Deportes card. Undefeated Roberto Ortiz defends his WBC silver light welterweight title against Reyes Sanchez in the main event. And in the co-feature, undefeated super flyweight Ivan Morales will defend his WBC international silver super flyweight title against Cesar Javier Gondra. In Baja California, Sur Mexico, the youngest of the Chavez clan, Omar Chavez, will see action against former 154-pound title holder Joaquim Aslin. In Panama, Del Istmo Promotions will have a card aired on Argentine TY Sports and Panama TV Max Channel 9 in the main event. Luis Concepcion defends his WBC silver flyweight title against Carlos Rubén Darío Ruiz. Sayana Mascara and Diana Corrado meet for the vacant IBO, female super featherweight world title as well. In Northern Ireland, United Kingdom, Barry McGuigan, MBE, will have EBU and IBF Intercontinental Super Bantamweight Champion and currently undefeated Carl Frampton against Jeremy Parodi. In defense of Frampton's titles as their main event, in a co-feature, Evan O'Kane takes on Kerry Hope for the vacant IBF Intercontinental Middleweight title. Denver, Colorado, HBO and Russian One TV will air top-ranked WBO welterweight main event between champion Mike Alvarado and Ruslan Provokanov. Former two-time lightweight champion Juan Diaz will be in his third bout of 2013 on the undercard in a light welterweight bout. In Atlantic City, New Jersey, Jimmy Birchfield's CES Boxing has a nice small card that, if in the area, I'd recommend getting tickets to. In the main event, Hammer and Hank Lundy is going to be in action. On the undercard, Chaz Witherspoon makes his return to the ring after losing to Seth Mitchell in April of 2012. Undefeated welterweight Anthony Young will be going after his 10th straight win. And Wednesday, October 23rd in Mexico, in an all-female card put on by Mayan Promotions, one of my favorite fighters and best defensive fighters in the game of the last decade, male or female, Alicia Ashley defends her WBC female super bantamweight title against Zenny Sotomayor. I just got to say, Bill, Alicia at 46 years old, she doesn't get, a lot of the recognition that she deserves. You know, she's like the female Bernard Hopkins. She never seems to age. I've seen her on several occasions at Gleason's in person, at some of the fantasy camps. She gives all these young fighters a lesson when they're in their sparring. And what I like about most with Alicia is, unlike a lot of champions, male or female, she's a true world champion in the proper definition, because Alicia will defend her title all over the world, and she does it time and again. And on the same day in South Wales, Australia, on Australia Main Event TV, former multi-division world champions Anthony Mundine and Shane Mosley meet for the vacant WBA International Light Middleweight title. And on the undercard, Chad Burnett and Jimax Jocko will meet for the vacant IBO Intercontinental Welterweight title.
You know, she's good-looking, too.
Yeah, she is. She's a very good-looking lady. And let me tell you, she's got to be one of the nicest people I've ever met, both her and her brother, Devon Cormack.
Good job there. And I didn't realize that Hammer and Hank Lundy fight was this weekend. He's not fighting anybody tough, though, is he?
You know, there's really no, I haven't gotten any information who he's fighting. I just know that he's on the card as the main event.
Yeah. And I saw that about Chaz Witherspoon, too. But anyway, we'll see. I guess he's continuing his career. But anyway, let's talk about Timothy Bradley, Juan Manuel Marquez. I know that you were in the chat room during our broadcast of it, so I know how you feel about it, but we didn't get a chance to talk on the air. I think Bradley is the real deal. I think he's getting better and better. It disappoints me a little bit to see Juan Manuel Marquez complaining and crying and saying he was robbed and stuff. And I mean, I scored the fight 117-111. I know a lot of people had it a little closer, 115-113. What's your thoughts on the fight, the results, and where they go from here?
I think I had it 117-112. Matter of fact, I think in the chat room that night when we were all discussing our scorecards, me and you had exactly the same, and I think one of the judges agreed with us totally. I can't remember which one it was. But, Juan Manuel Marquez, he has turned into kind of a sore loser over the years. In some ways, I can understand. He really has been shorted in a lot of his big fights with Manny Pacquiao. He was definitely shorted, in his fight against Chris John. So I can kind of understand how he gets a little bit bitter. You know, he's older in his career. You know, he's really at the tail end, even though, his skills really haven't declined much. But, I think, he wants to go out on the win. He's not trying to stick around for too much longer. Maybe he wanted this to be his signature fight. But, I'm very disappointed with how much griping he's doing. Not even so much him, but more or less his strength and conditioning coach is the one who's really making up the big stink. But, the way I look at it is, listen, you've been caught of dealing with PEDs, with PEDs. All of a sudden, Juan Manuel Marquez, he beefs up overnight for the Pacquiao fight. He looks like a monster. He's just totally, reinvigorated himself. So, yeah, those questions are definitely valid questions, in my opinion. But Timothy Bradley has done a great job. I interviewed Timothy Bradley back when he was, 11-0. A funny story real quick is, I remember after I did the interview with him, I said I would send him a link before he came up. And Timothy tells me, he goes, well, I don't even have a computer and I don't even have an email address, but I'm going to give you my girlfriend's computer. My girlfriend's email address is now his wife. I had sent it over to her. Donaire. So, but at that point in time, I had interviewed Timothy, I had interviewed Nino Donaire, and I'm trying to remember who else I interviewed at the time, but, you know, they all promised that they were going to be the next big things in the sport. But I always thought that Timothy Bradley was going to be a future pound-for-pound champion, only because the way he spoke, Bill, it wasn't, you know, with any cockiness or arrogance, but, you know, with such conviction, you know, he believed so much in himself. And, you know, just time and again, he has proved himself. He doesn't get the recognition he deserves. You know, when nobody else, when everybody was trying to make these big fights, you know, he was the only one, him and Devin Alexander, you know, when both of them were champions, they were the only ones who were willing to meet each other. You know, and Timothy is just time after time has proven he'll fight anybody. His style is a little bit boring at times. Yes, you know, he does rush in there with the head and stuff like that, but he's definitely the real deal. And I just don't understand why fans don't give him, or even worse yet, the media doesn't give him the recognition he deserves. But, you know, he definitely beat Juan Manuel Marquez.
Well, you know, I think that some of it had to do... Remember, he signed with Top Rank recently, you know, in the last couple of years, 2 years or whatever. I think that that probably was one of the reasons why he's not as well known. It's the same syndrome as Andre Ward. Andre Ward, a great fighter and everything else, but he signed with Goosen, you know, and they don't promote their guys. You know, you know, it's just it's not like Top Rank and Golden Boy. They're out there, and you know who their fighters are. You see them. You see stories about them. You know, they're in the news. You know, and I think that's what Bradley needs. It's funny. I had Bradley on the show a couple of times. One of the interviews, I think, is up under the hot interview section, and it was like a last-minute thing. He was just on the internet, and he stumbled across. He saw that I was online or something, and we got him on. So it was pretty cool. But anyway, Vasyl Lomachenko, whether he made his pro debut or whether he was in his seventh pro fight, we don't know until they make a decision with those World Series of Boxing fights that are on his record, although BoxRec doesn't show them, Fight Facts does. You know, some of the people that we were doing the commentating broadcast were really hard on Lomachenko, feeling that he shouldn't be in the limelight with his first pro fight and everything else. And I look at it a little differently, Dax. I'm seeing a guy that has 397 amateur fights against the best fighters in the world, all the Cuban teams and the Mexican teams and the Russian teams, et cetera, or Ukrainian teams. And you know, this guy showed us that he's a pretty refined fighter in the fight on Saturday. Where do you see him going?
I definitely agree. He is a guy that has the skills. He's definitely a guy that, you know, you're not going to get any more refined. I think we spoke about this before on different fighters, that, you know, once you get to those many amateur fights, once, you know, you have fought and beaten so many of those guys that at that level, you know, whether it be the Olympics, whether it be, you know, international games and stuff like that, you know, there's not really much more that you can really do with your skill set. Guillermo Rigondeaux is a perfect example. You know, a lot of those amateurs, believe it or not, are better than a lot of our pro fighters, you know, even our world champions, because at that point in time, they're still hungry, they're still trying to make their decision on what they're going to do with themselves. My own, you know, I think he's the real deal. I really believe that, you know, he's going to have a bright future. He's definitely going to be a champion. My only hang up on that, and I think we talked about that on the show before the fight took place, is, you know, there's a lot of other guys out there who have been around a lot longer, who have put in their dues as a professional, as well as an amateur, who haven't gotten the title shots, whether it be minor or world. You know, so I just think that's a little bit unfair to them. But then again, you know, we have seen it happen in the past. Leon Spinks against Ali. Rigondeaux, I think he was a world champion before he had even 9 pro fights. So it's whatever's going to be good for boxing right now. I definitely think he's more exciting and more worth a watch than the Chinese guy that was the Chinese Olympian that, you know, got all that attention when he made his pro debut. What do you think?
Yeah, I agree with you there. And you know what? You see, that's the argument. That's the reason why, you know, titles don't mean anything, wins don't mean anything. You know, you look at Lomachenko, and you look at the level of opposition that he fought and all those gold medals he won. And I'm not just talking about the gold medals for the two Olympics that he won. He won gold medals in all the other games that they have when it's not the Olympics. And, you know, he fought the best. And you look at a guy, forget about 397 fights. You know, you take the 25 top fighters he fought, and you look at a pro that's got 25 fights under his belt, I guarantee you, and you know as well as I, that those 25 fights are going to be against way less opposition, quality opposition, than what Lomachenko faced in those worldwide games.
Most definitely. Absolutely. I agree 100%. On that, you know, so right now it's I think, you know, it's about what's good for boxing, you know, in the overall. But then again, you know, as you just said, and you know, I was kind of getting around to, you know, it really does water down the value of titles. You know, it's almost as we said it before, for you not to win a world title, or at least, you know, since, you know, a minor title, like, you know, a silver title or something like that, nowadays means, you know, you're doing something right, because these world titles don't mean anything. Right now, you know, it is, it's the lineal titles that mean something, because the world titles, you know, they're giving out like Pez lately.
Yeah, no, they really don't mean anything. I don't care if it's a linear or not, because what happens is, the fighter, listen, we see what the sanctioning bodies do, Dax. Well, we just saw it happen in the light heavyweight division. You know, you got the, what's his name over there? Bibot Shumanov has not been able to find somebody to fight him. And then somebody went to the WBA and said, hey, we want to fight for the belt. We got the fight set. We got sanctioning fees. Here you go. So what does the WBA do? They call up Shumanov and say, hey, we've just elevated you. You're now the super light heavyweight champion, and we vacated your belt so they can collect the coin. It's all about buying the belts. And we see it with Golden Boy. They build up their fighters and they buy them a belt. We saw it with Andre Berto. We saw it with so many fighters. And, you know, it's terrible.
And WBA is not the only one.
No. I'm just using that as an example.
You're having a conversation about somebody who took over a certain sanctioning body and sent me something that says, if you got money, I got title shots.
Right. Well, that's the bottom line.
And he didn't even know what fighters, you know, we had or anything. That's all he told me, is if you got money, I got title shots.
Yeah, well, that's that is the truth. You know, I mean, it's funny. But anyway, this weekend we got a pretty big fight on tap. Mike Alvarado against Ruslan Pradagnikov. You know, it's a tough fight to pick, Dax, to be honest with you, because both fighters, you know, I mean, you look at the skill and you know, let's be real, they're both kind of limited in overall boxing ability, but they're both very entertaining fighters. Mike Alvarado boxed Bam Bam Rios in the second fight to win. I'm thinking, and this is just, you know, today, I'm thinking that Alvarado is going to try to outbox Pradagnikov, but Alvarado likes to mix it up too. How do you see this one going, man? It's a tough one.
Pravakadov has, like, an amazing chin, doesn't he? Yeah. But what's even more is, you know, not so much a chin, is that he can go in there for a war of attrition and just stand there and keep taking it and taking it. I don't think Mike Alvarado would be able to stand in there and go the distance with Pravakadov like that. That was his biggest downfall in the first Bam Bam Rios fight, was, you know, he got more tired than Rios did. And, you know, the war between them, you know, wore him down physically, you know, and that's what made Bam Bam's job easier later in the later rounds. So he's definitely going to have to box Pravakadov. If he does get caught up into a war, I see Ruslan, you know, beating him. I see, you know, Ruslan actually knocking him out, because Ruslan's a bigger guy. He's not a bigger one-shot puncher, but, you know, his volume punching and, you know, his ability to take a shot and just keep coming at you would just be way too much. But I think Alvarado, if he boxes him, he's going to win. But if he goes in there and tries to stand toe-to-toe like Timothy Bradley did, it's not going to work out well for him. But I'm going to pick Alvarado, because I'm guessing he's going to fight smart. You know, I'd like to think so.
You know, at one time, many people thought that Omar Chavez was actually the more talented son of Julio Cesar Chavez Sr. He's fighting this weekend against Joanchim Alsine. What do you think in this fight? This is obviously his toughest opponent to date. He does have a couple of losses on his resume against you know, mediocre fighters, and Alsine has had some trouble too. This seems like, you know, I hate to use the cliche, but it looks like a crossroads fight. You know, the young fighter, you know, with running out of chances, going up against an older fighter that's running out of chances. Who do you see in this one?
You know, looking at outside his last few fights, you know, he's definitely done. If Omar can't beat him, then, you know, Omar really has no future. Omar's got, he's got a very good chin. He's a pretty good puncher. I mean, not a solid, you know, knockout artist. You know, it definitely doesn't hit as hard as his brother, but he's a pretty good puncher. I think his two losses both came to Jorge Paez Jr., if I'm not mistaken. I think Omar has a little bit of problems with guys that move around a lot, you know, who are a little bit cutesy, which Paez Jr. is. So, you know, and definitely Alcine doesn't move around too much anymore. So I think Chavez should win this by KO. And if he doesn't, then, you know, like you said, you know, it's a crossroads. I don't expect much more out of him. What I just never really understood was, why is this a case of, like, you know, daddy's favorite or something? Because the last time we really seen Omar, you know, with Chavez Sr. when he was a kid, when he used to get brought to the ring and stuff like that. But, you know, it just seems like, you know, his father, you know, Chavez, Julio Sr., just doesn't seem as excited about Omar's career as he is about Junior's career. Why, I don't know, maybe it's just me, but, you know, it just, you never really hear him talk much about Omar. But I think Omar, you know, he's got some talent, but, you know, I just think that he has a harder road than his brother did.
Yeah, he may. We'll see. I think this is a good test for him. One last thing. What's your thoughts? You mentioned the fight between Manuel Char and Denis Bakatov. Did you know that they're fighting for not only the collection of belts that Manuel Char has, but also the WBC has that new belt? It's the WBC CISBB belt, which is for boxers that are from the former Soviet Union. What do you think of that, man? I thought I heard it all until I heard that one.
Yeah, I I don't even know what to think of that title. It's just, why don't we just make it up as we go along?
I don't get it, man. I don't get it.
Just make it up as we go along. You know, why don't we just, you know, call it, you know, why don't we just make up, like, you know, the PMBP champion, you know, just pay me B champion, you know. I don't get it. So, I really have no comment on it. It's just one of those SMHs, you know, shake my heads.
Yeah,
it's... But, you know, as far as the collection of titles that he has, I mean, they're pretty worthless as well. And I don't mean that to be insulting, but, you know, they're just, again, you know, you might as well just say, hey, listen, I'm champion. And then, you know, this just goes back to what I said. If you don't have a title nowadays, there's something wrong. Or you're doing something right.
Well, more people have titles than people that don't, you know. So it's pretty, it's a joke. But anyway, Dax, great job as usual. And we'll be looking forward to you next week, my man.
All right, and we didn't get across that couple quotes from today's press
conference. Oh, yeah. Tell me about, that's right. You're supposed to tell me some press conference up in Canada. What went down there?
Yeah, today we had the press conference between Tony Bellew and Adonna Stevenson. Our good friend Gary Dawson went up there, and he had covered it, and he sent me all the quotes. And, you know, there was a couple interesting things which I really liked on there, you know. Usual back and forth talk, you know. Tony Bellew says, you know, the fight's coming back into the UK. Adonis said he's going to give Bellew a gift, he's going to give him a KO. But Sugar Hill guaranteed 100% that the fight's going to be a KO finish for Stevenson. He said, you know, probably more likely it's not going to go past the fifth round. But what I found really interesting is Bellew was talking about, you know, Carl Froch, and, you know, that him and Carl Froch both believed that, you know, they had seen some real big holes inside Stevenson's game, and Carl Froch and Bellew are both confident that Tony's going to take the title from Adonis. And Bellew had stated, he said, you know, yeah, I'm not the worst cloud, I'm not Chad Dawson, you know, that you made them seem like easy fights, but, you know, neither one of them were motivated, and I'm looking for a title, and, you know, I'm going to be the toughest fight that you've had to date. Which, you know, to be honest with you, when you think about those fights and you think about Tony Bellew, I'm kind of inclined to be, you know, agree with him on that. Not so much say that, you know, he's going to win, but, you know, this might be Adonis's toughest fight to date.
I don't know, man. Adonis Stevenson looked pretty complete in his last fight against Trout. Against Cloud. So
yeah, well, Cloud wasn't throwing much back though either.
No, he was. Stevenson. I don't know, man. I'm sold on Stevenson. I had my doubts. I thought that he was foolish for taking the Cloud fight, and he proved this all wrong.
I did too as well. You know, I think we talked about on the show, and I was very impressed with the way that he has worked so hard in the gym, because you can definitely see the improvements on him. You know, when, I'm not saying that Tony Bellew's going to win. I just think it's going to be a really good fight, and probably one of Adonis' toughest fights to date. I'll just still have to, you know, stay with my my belief that, you know, if Adonis Stevenson steps in there with the Russian Kovalev, he's going to lose that belt.
Yeah, well, that's going to be the one that everybody wants to see, so... But anyway, thanks for the comments. I didn't have those on in front of me, so that's good stuff, man. I appreciate it.
My man gave it to me straight from the press conference. He wasn't even out the door of the DoubleTree Hotel, and he had sent them over to me.
Sounds good, man. Tell him I said thanks, and we'll be looking forward to you next week, man.
All right, everybody. Have a good weekend. Enjoy the fights.
All right, brother. Dax Khan, check out his column on BillyCBoxing.com. You can... see the column. It's up there. It's up there, man. Just go check it out. That's all I can tell you. But anyway, a couple other things real quick. There was supposed to be a fight this weekend with flyweight champion Maruti Muthani and a Paisan, of course. And he had his mandatory title defense against Silvio Altenu. But apparently Muthani had to pull out of the fight, and the fight is off. And in the main, in the that was the co-main event for the Stiglitz fight. So the Muthani fight is off, and apparently he had turned down a $50,000 offer from the promoter, and wanted the fight to go to a purse bid. And the purse bid actually came in at 12 grand. You know, he wanted, he said no to 50, and the purse bid was 12 grand. His opponent was going to get $1,000, $1,800 for the fight for a world title. Muthani was going to get 11,000. He should have taken the 50 grand and ended up withdrew from the fight. Because of the amount of money. It wasn't an injury or anything like that. But in the meantime, the main event is still going to go on between Robert Stiglitz and his opponent, Ekpo, is how you say his last name. So we'll have to wait and see how that one goes. We'll be breaking those down on tomorrow. We were Dax was just talking about... the fights that were taking place. He gave us his boxing schedule roundup, and he and I were talking about Omar, businessman Chavez, and he's taken on a pretty tough fighter, I think, at least as far as his career goes, against Joachim Alcine. And, you know, Dax was right. You know, George Pérez Jr., was the kryptonite for Omar Chavez. I think this is a big fight for him. You will get to see it if you have Unimas. And also the co-main event is Raul Morales going up against Frankie Leal. So it ought to be interesting there. In Chicago, you know, the Polish light heavyweight contender, he's ranked in several of the sanctioning bodies. His name is Andres Fonfara. According to the news yesterday, two different promoters in the Chicago area claim that he's under a promotional contract with each of them, Eight Count Promotions and on also Round 3 Productions. Now, Fonfara came on and issued a press release stating that he is indeed with Eight Count and Pelusi, so who knows? We'll probably hear something about a court date coming up soon on that as well. Listen, I got some quotes from these guys, from obviously the Bernard Hopkins and Karo Murat fight, and the Paulie Malignaggi and Zab Judah press conference that I didn't get to yesterday. I do want to mention a couple of things real quick before I take a break. Daniel Ponce de Leon is returning to the ring on November 16th. The fight's scheduled to take place in Mexico. We don't know who he's fighting yet, so we'll keep you posted on that. Also, Sergio Martinez. Remember last week we told you that he was going to meet the Pope, Pope Francis, and he was there. He went to the Vatican today, and or actually yesterday, and presented the Pope with a honorary WBC championship belt, which had the Pope's picture on it and everything else. Apparently, they spoke for about a half a minute. That's it. The Pope took the belt and gave it to an aide and continued moving on. You know, so maybe he's not that big of a boxing fan or something. I don't know, but I thought that Martinez was going to get a little more time from the Pope than that.
Talking Boxing with Billy C. Every week, 2 hours of the best boxing talk on the radio.
I have a bunch of questions, Donnell, right? If you feel like you want to, you can answer for J.D. first. Why will you win? J.D. Chapman, why will you win?
Maybe Holmes will get sick and get hit by a train that day on the way to the title. He might have diarrhea. He might have the flu. He might throw up. One of his eyeballs might fall out that day, and I might get lucky.
Talking Boxing with Billy C.
In the real world, life has its shares of trials and tribulations, but you don't have to face them alone. This is Patricia Campanaro of Campanaro and Tomkovich. If you are facing emotionally difficult family legal issues from divorce to child custody, reach out to the team that will dedicate themselves to fighting for you, the team of Campanaro and Tomkovich. With almost 30 years of experience handling divorce, child custody, legal guardianship, visitation, and other legal issues dealing with family concerns, we can help you resolve the problems you are facing with professionalism and care. Our supportive staff is always ready to assist you with any questions or concerns you may have. To find out more about Campanaro and Tomkovich, visit us at DuchessNYLaw.com or call us and speak to a member of our attentive staff at 845-221-4099. That's 845-221-4099. Don't be surprised at court with inexperienced representation. At Campanaro and Tomkovich, we have been helping our clients get the justice they deserve for almost 30 years, and we could do the same for you.
Now back to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. He may not have an Excellence in Broadcasting Award, but the night's still young.
And he's got martinis.
So you never know what may be by morning. It's Talkin' Boxing with Billy C.
Talkin' Boxing with Billy C.
The one, the only, Don King.
Makes me feel good, Billy, to have you, the number one show in the country, Talking Boxing with Billy. So I invite each and every American that's listening to this great show to tune in, because we want you to be there with Billy and me.
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C show. You're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. Glad you could join us. And if you don't have the Fight Now channel on your sports channel lineup, you need to call your local television provider and tell them that you want Fight Now right now. It's that simple. Pick up the phone and call. Remember the WBC put out, or they started the World, not the World Series of Boxing, the World Cup of Boxing. This weekend was supposed to start it off, and there was actually a couple, two good fights on it that we had on our challenge. Olander Solis was one of them. Well, they decided that in respect for Jose Suleiman, who they call Don Suleiman, as in, you know, the Don, because he's still recovering from his surgery in UCLA Medical Center in California, and he would not be able to make it, they decided in respect they would postpone the card that was scheduled for this weekend. So they canceled it. Not only did they cancel it, but Samson Lukovic of Lukovic Boxing, he canceled next week's World Cup of Boxing event was taking place in Argentina. So you got back-to-back World Cup boxing events canceled because Jose Suleiman, you know, isn't around. You know, how ridiculous is that? You know, I mean, I don't know if you follow football, but Adrian Peterson is one of the premier running backs in the NFL. He plays for the Minnesota Vikings, and he played football last week You know, why does that surprise anybody? Because his two-year-old son, had died the couple of days before Sunday. And he still went and played football. Now, there's some weird situations about the kid wasn't living with Adrian Peterson or anything like that. But still, you know, how heartbroken was he? And he still played. Now, he uses football to you know, cope with negativity. But you're telling me that they have to postpone not one but two entire cards because Jose Suleiman couldn't be ringside? Come on, man. Come on. What happens if, God forbid, something happened to him? He didn't make it through to the surgery. Would they have, you know, got rid of the idea? I mean, it makes no sense. You know, we had, you know, whatever. Let's talk about the quotes from the press conferences. Zeb Judah, Paulie Malignaggi, I didn't get a chance to read them yesterday, but I'm going to read you the quotes from these guys as they promoted. They did their press conference the other day to promote their December 7th showdown, which is taking place in Brooklyn at the Barclays Center. Zeb Judah, who's a two-division world champion that he won the belt five times total, says, once again, here we are. This is truly one fight that I never thought that we'd be looking at. And I'd be on the other side of the coin. There's so much history here with Paulie. He says, I lost my last fight here at Barclays, and Paulie lost his last fight here at Barclays, and it didn't mean anything. We are still two dynamite fighters. Our skills speak for themselves. A lot of people wanted this fight to happen. Who? Who wants this fight to happen? He says, on December 7th, we're coming to bring the fireworks. Yeah, both fighters are not known for their knockout ability, but they'll bring their fireworks on December 7th. He says, I've known Paulie for a long time. I watch him grow throughout the years. I've always been very proud of him because he represented Brooklyn. I always stood by his side. On December 7th, you're going to see a great fight. You're going to see some of the fastest hands in the world. We might break a jab count record because I throw lots of jabs and Paulie throws lots of jabs. I think we are going to have we're going to give a good, classy act of boxing that night. Get ready. He says, my main edge over Paulie will be my hand speed and punching power. Paulie has quick hands too, but he throws a lot of punches, but he's got nothing to hold me off, basically saying, you punch like a girl. He says, it's been proven in the past that you have to know how to hold me back. He says, he can punch. We're going to see. I've been waking up and going to the gym, sparring young guys and training. I'm already putting in lots of work at the gym. I'm ready for the fight. Paulie Malignaggi, he said, I've been around Zeb Judah for a long time and never expected to be across the ring from him. But, you know, we have to give Brooklyn what Brooklyn wants, so it starts there. Again, Brooklyn doesn't care about you two guys, man. They really don't. You know, I just don't get it. You know, it's nice to have it in Brooklyn. It's nice that they're both there, but especially Zeb. Especially Zeb. Anyway, Paulie says, Zeb and I go back a long way. I can remember when Zeb worked my corner for a fight in 1999. When I was in as an amateur. He says, Zeb was an honorary coach and working a corner for all the amateurs. He actually trained us that week. So we go back even before I was a pro, seeing Zeb in the gym, seeing Zeb sparring, even before I had my first amateur fight. I kind of got a late start in boxing. I was 16 when I started, and I had my first amateur fight when I was 17, so I had always heard about Zeb through the years. It's been a long road. It's had its ups and downs. Speaking of the last fight, some things still irk me. That result definitely irks me. I don't mind losing a decision. It's close and can go both ways. Things happen. There hasn't been a day since June 22nd that I don't get at least one or two people, no matter what city I'm in, come up and say, Paulie, you got screwed in that fight. He really didn't. It was a close fight, and getting screwed means that, you know, the Manny Pacquiao got screwed against Timothy Bradley. You know, this fight was a close fight. I'm sorry, he didn't get screwed. It was a close fight. It could have gone either way, but anyway. He says, on December 7th, Zeb and I are going to put on a great show. It's going to be the best main event we've had yet, and that the fans will look forward to it because we have the perfect venue for it. When they made Barclays Center, it was made for fights like this. This is going to be a civil war. Whenever you have a fight at a high level, you're always representing your city, the city you come from. It's usually Brooklyn against another city. But being it's Brooklyn against Brooklyn, it becomes a borough divided, and you end up taking two neighborhoods. So it's going to be a neighborhood against a neighborhood. That's the only part of this fight I like. Bensonhurst against... I know one of them is in Bensonhurst, and the other one is... I forget the other area of Brooklyn that the Flatbush maybe I forget the other one. They had the jerseys on. I forget now. I'm looking at right at him in my face, and I can't think of it. I'm looking at him in my mind, and I can't think of it. But anyway, he says it's an old school fight. It's the way old school fighters came up, winning their regions first, and then moving up to the world stage. We've been both on the world stage now, and now we're bringing it to the grassroots again. I've fought friends in the amateurs, but never in the pros. Once the bell rings, we both have a goal. We're both competitors, and we both want to win. Well, once somebody lands that first punch, then the other guy will hit you a little harder. Before you know it, you're mad and in the mood for the fight. Zab's a crafty guy, a veteran, very versatile, and he still has those fast hands, and he's a southpaw. He's been around a long time because of his ability and his craftiness and his intelligence, so there's some stuff to deal with. But that's why you go to training camp. You devise a plan, and you put all the time into it and put it together. I expect a tough fight. There's a lot on the line. He says, I don't think anybody wants to lose in their home city to another guy from his home city. There's a lot of bragging rights on the line. I expect both of us to fight hard and leave nothing in the ring. I expect it to be entertaining for everyone. You know, the one thing that surprised me about this, these, and I had a chance to review them yesterday, but didn't get a chance to read them on air. One thing that surprised me is that virtually no trash talk from two highly competitive trash talkers. You know, Zeb Judah and Paulie Malignaggi both have known how to sling a little trash, and neither one of them slung any in the press conference, which I think shows that they truly and genuinely have some respect for each other, which is good. A point that Paulie made, I agree with 100%. You know, back in the day, neighborhood fights were very common. It's what the backbone of the sport is. We've gotten away from it. You know, people are afraid, politically correct. You know, you're afraid to say, you know, it's the Italians against the Germans this week. Or you know, it's the Italians against the Jews, or the Polish against the Irish, or something like that. You know, everybody's so afraid to offend somebody that we don't even get those anymore. I think Alex Papali and myself did a broadcast on a fight in I believe it was Albany, and that's exactly what they did. They billed an Italian versus Irish. And all the fights were, one side was Italian, the other side was Irish. And it was really one of the first times, aside from a Jimmy Birchfield show that I went to back in the day, where, you know, they actually build it like that. And I think that that's cool. And I think we need more of that. And people got to stop with all of this other crap. Bernard Hopkins and Karo Murat, they had their one of their most recent press conferences. I don't know if it's a final one. I think they're going to have one more next week. Bernard Hopkins says, I'm looking forward to Saturday, meaning next Saturday. He says, to again add another page to my long book. When you're young, you're trying to find excuses why a 40-year-old guy shouldn't beat you. And when you get in the ring, you realize you're in the ring with me, and you see that this isn't easy. That you might have thought. It's the ultimate shock and surprise that will always catch a person who's not prepared off guard. Casey hasn't noticed. He's 48. He's almost as old as me. He says he's already in awe of Bernard Hopkins. He's already lost four rounds. Bernard, stop. You know, Bernard Hopkins, they shouldn't let him speak in public. He can't speak in public. I don't even know what language he speaks. Karo Murat says he has to see that the time has come. We're again fighting again in Atlantic City, which means because they were supposed to fight the first time and they couldn't. They never fought already. So it would be a good closing out for him to finally retire at the hands of mine. He has pretty much the experience that no other boxer has, but you'll see in the ring that he's just trying to get one punch or a 1-2 combination, and then he clinches, and that's what he does, which is true. I mean, let's be real. He doesn't do much. He's not exciting. Bernard Hopkins is an extremely boring fighter. There's no question about it. Never was exciting. Never was, even in his heyday. When he was a middleweight champion, he didn't do all that much either. Yeah, that's what he says, and I agree with him. But nowadays, all you do is you see him clinch and throw one or two punches, and that's because he's old. He says it may be conditioning, but I don't think so. Listen, Murat can say all he wants. Unfortunately, I don't think that his vocabulary is going to beat Bernard Hopkins next weekend. I think Bernard Hopkins is just, even at 48, just that much better than Karo Murat, but we'll see. We've been talking a lot about Juan Manuel Marquez and the Trail of Tears from Las Vegas all the way to Mexico, him complaining about the result with the Timothy Bradley fight and everything else. Well, I'm shocked. I can't stand when fighters cry and complain about that, you know. But I'm even more shocked at Danny O'Connor. Now, Danny O'Connor fought arguably a totally put-a-fork-in-him, he's done fighter in Vivian Harris this past weekend, and he lost. And he said, I don't feel like a loser. Everybody that was there felt I won. The judges scored the fight pretty crazy. One judge scored it 10 rounds to none in favor of Danny O'Connor, 100 to 90. But the other two judges scored the bout in Vivian Harris's favor, 96-94 and 99-91. I mean, talk about crazy, crazy scores. You got one guy that scores every round for Danny O'Connor. You got one guy scoring almost every round but one for Vivian Harris. And then another guy in the middle, 96-94, who had it a close fight. They're really pissed off. They said that the judging is bad. This took place in Philadelphia. So Greg Serb, who's the commissioner, I'm sure is going to look into it. So we'll have to wait and see. I'm just shocked that Danny is crying so much. I mean, you can't, you lose, you lose. You get robbed, you got robbed. I mean, that's the way it is. Complaining and stuff isn't going to, it only makes you look like an idiot. Well, my man Henry Haskup, who had some stuff to do today, wasn't able to come by, but he said there's been a lot of other wide scoring differences throughout the history of the sport, and he wanted to bring a couple to my attention. In 1995, Kenny Keene fought Bobby Crabtree, and one judge scored the fight 120 to 108 for Keene. That's 12 rounds for Keene. Another had it 119-111 for Crabtree, and the third had it 108. I'm sorry, the third had it 116-115. So again, almost identical to what happened to Danny O'Connor. And when Sugar Ray Robinson lost to Paul Bender, Pender, one of the judges scored that fight 142 to 146. And another judge had it 147 to 138. And that was in favor of Sugar Ray Robinson. And the third judge had it 142 to 148. So, all crazy, crazy scores. We'll see what happens there. So, it's not like it just happened once. It's happened many times throughout the history of our sport. So, one final thing I wanted to get to. Ricky Hatton was interviewed yesterday, and he said that he thinks that not only does Amir Khan deserve his shot at Floyd, but he thinks that he's got a really good chance of beating Floyd. And he said, listen, I'm not going to officially pick Amir Khan. He said, but I think that Amir Khan has a really good chance of beating Floyd Mayweather. So I think he deserves the shot. I'm saying to myself, What the hell is Ricky Hatton back on the white stuff, or is he on something else, or is he boozing it up again? I mean, what's going on? I mean, let's be real. I know we've talked a little about that fight. It is in BoxRec. It's not been announced. It's not made official yet. They're probably waiting a little longer. But that fight is a terrible fight. It's a typical easy layup fight for Floyd. It shows us nothing. Like I said earlier in the broadcast, the only thing that I would like to see, if we have to see the fight, is I'd like to see the fight in England. And, you know, just to have Floyd have one thing not in his favor. You know, how Floyd always has to have everything in his favor. That would be one thing. Not that it would make a difference, because I don't think that Amir Khan will stand a chance against Floyd. I just don't think he'll get close enough to Floyd. And I think that the main interest in Floyd, if Floyd does fight Amir Khan, I think the main interest in Floyd for fighting Amir Khan is simply one reason. They want a knockout. They want to knock somebody out. Floyd can't knock anybody out. Floyd's got the girly hands. He can't knock anybody out. So they're trying to pick opponents now that maybe he can knock out. And Amir Khan, with the old glass chin, maybe he's got a shot. I hope that fight doesn't happen, but let's stop talking about it until it's officially announced. Now, we are going to be getting Marty Mulcahy scheduled to join us in a little bit. So with that said, I'm going to do this a little early.
Wake up. It's time for the... Ooh.
It's too early
for a trivia question.
Question.
Today's It's Too Early for a Trivia Question. Question is being brought to us by the Gentleman Boxer book. This is a must read for all boxing fans, whether you're a diehard fan or a casual fan. Get yourself a copy now by visiting my friend's website who wrote the book, Ian Grumeza, www.iangrumeza.com. That's iangrumeza.com. You won't regret it. And the trivia question is also being brought to us in part by the Titty Grab game. It's an adult game, a break the ice game for boys and girls and maybe a little alcohol. Check out their website, www.tittygrab.com. Our trivia question, which is supplied by our very own trivia question guru, Henry Haskup, is a tough one. I got a ton of answers yesterday or the day before on this question, and then I gave a huge hint yesterday and got no answers. So here it goes again. Over 50 future champions lost their pro debut. But which champion took the most attempts to get his first pro win? I told you how many fights it took for this guy to get his first win yesterday, and the answer is 7. He won his 7th attempt, so his first six fights did not end in a win. I'll give you the initial of his last name. His initial of his last name begins with an E. His initial of his last name begins with an E. So which future champion or which former champion took 7 fights to get his first win? So he won his 7th fight, did not win his first 6. His last name begins with an E. Good luck to everybody on that. Email me the correct answer, Billy@TalkinBoxing. That's TalkinBoxing.com. And if you're the first one to get it right, you'll win the prize. Good luck on that one.
This day in boxing history.
And finally, this day in boxing history is being brought to us by Campanero and Tomkovich. If you're looking for a lawyer, use the ones that keep my ass out of trouble. That is Campanero and Tomkovich. Give them a call today, 845-221-4099. That's 845-221-4099. Don't forget to tell them Billy C sent you and that I'm going to pick up the consultation fee. They just love it when they hear that. 845-221-4099. On this day, October 17th, and don't forget, we're hanging around a little longer today because Marty Mulcahy is going to be joining us here in a couple of minutes. But on this day, October 17th in 1962, this is an interesting one. Because this particular fight happens to have been the very first world title in the junior, the new created junior middleweight division, and on this day, October 17th, 1962, Emil Griffith wins a 15-round decision over Ted Wright to win the vacant European World Junior Middleweight title. Now, 2 months later, we had another one here in the States, but Emil Griffith won the first one in 1962 on this date in Vienna. On this day, October 17th in 1973, Ben Villaflor. Now, we talked about him yesterday. He lost a belt, but he won it back on this day in 1973 when he knocked out Kunaki Shibata in the first round to regain his WBA World Junior Lightweight belt, and that took place in Honolulu. On this day, October 17th in 1938, Joey Archibald wins a 15-round decision over Mike Bellosi to win the vacant New York World Featherweight title. That took place in New York City on this day in 1938. On this day in 1904, Joe Bowker wins a 20-round decision over Frankie Neal to win the World Bantamweight title. That took place in London on this day in 1904. Check this out. Here you go around the block again. On this day, October 17th in 1910, Digger Stanley knocks out Joe Bowker in the eighth round to win the vacant British World Bantamweight title. And again, that fight took place in London. And last but not least, on this day, October 17th in 1999, Yosam Choi wins a 12-round decision over Saman Sorjatyurong to win the WBC Junior Flyweight title, and that took place in Seoul, Korea on this day in 1999. So some interesting stuff taking place on this day back all those years. But anyway, like I said, we did our trivia question and also this day in history a little early today because we're waiting to get a hold of Marty Mulcahy, and we should have him on the line right now. What's up, Marty?
Hey, doing well. Picked up on the first ring, and other than a slight echo, everything's going great.
Hey, man, don't jinx it, because you know, we'll live with the little echo, because the alternative is nothing at all. But anyway, you know how the phone line is, so let's get rocking and rolling here. Timothy Bradley against Juan Manuel Marquez. You know, I thought the fight was entertaining. I've heard so many mixed opinions of this, Marty. Some people say the fight was boring. Some people said the pay-per-view was terrible. I actually enjoyed it. I enjoyed the Lomachenko fight. I even liked the Battle of the Orlandos. But I really liked the Timothy Bradley fight. To me, he showed that he was smart. He fought the smart fight. And I don't think the fight was close. I scored it 117-111. And I'm disappointed in Juan Manuel Marquez, crying all the way back to Mexico, complaining, and just like you said, and it stuck in my head for the whole week, that you know, he doesn't want to give Manny a shot, and it's like he took the baseball and went home. What's your thoughts on the card, and specifically the Bradley-Marquez fight?
I'm with you on the card. I thought the most intriguing thing about this card was Vasyl Lomachenko. You know, the fantastic amateur, you know, Olympic champion. And he showed all the class. And you know, it was the thing is, could he live up to the hype? And given an excellent opponent, yes, he more than lived up to the hype. And, you know, hey, this is his first shot out of the gate from an amateur, and he gets a body blow knockout. That's what you want to see. It's a little bit reminiscent of Wigan Diao. You know, he was the last great amateur to come out of the amateur ranks, and he scored, like, I think first three of his first five knockouts were by the body shot. So, I don't know, maybe there's something about the amateurs. Maybe the body shot is not a lost art. And, you know, if you have a good enough amateur background, you can mix in the body shots. So Lomachenko was the big takeaway, I think, from that whole pay-per-view card. I mean, we know what Tim Bradley's about. We know what Juan Marquez is about and where they're at in their careers. Lomachenko was the positive takeaway for me. The most negative takeaway from the fight is what you said, you know, the crybaby antics of Marquez afterwards, you know, saying that, you know, yeah, I was robbed in this fight. If I go to Las Vegas, I'm never going to get the win. You know, he acts like he was not the money guy in Vegas. Usually the money guy gets the nod if it's a close fight in Vegas. He was the money guy, and he didn't get the nod, and that's simply because Timothy Bradley beat him straight up and down. Like you, I thought it was an entertaining fight, and I think some of the rounds were close, but they always lean Bradley's way. And I keep going back to one saying I have. You know, Timothy Bradley was a little bit faster, a little bit younger, a little bit quicker on his feet, and he got to the point of engagement a little bit quicker. And in boxing, the little things mean a lot. And Tim Bradley did all the little things to get a big victory.
You know, once again, Nacho Berenstein effed up. he's telling Juan Manuel Marquez that he's comfortably ahead. Relax, you know, don't kill yourself. And, you know, he's already done that to Marquez, I know of, twice. He's done it to other fighters. You know, when does a trainer have to take the blame? You know, first of all, what trainer would tell their fighter to take the foot off the gas pedal? It makes no sense at all to me, Marty. I mean, what's your thoughts on that move?
Well, the only other thought, you know, when you mentioned a guy, you know, who would tell a guy to take it off the gas pedal, the first fight that came to my mind was, you know, Lou Duva back in the day with Meldrick Taylor, not telling his guy to stay away, you know, but he had, maybe it's just the way he saw it, because, you know, it was kind of like Meldrick Taylor had to fight against Julio Cesar Chavez in the bag. He just needed to stay away. And, you know, Lou Duva, you know, it kind of went with your thinking, you know, never tell a guy that he's ahead. Never let him, you know, get that sense of ease inside the ring. And, you know, these two have been together for so long that I'm not going to second-guess Nacho Berenstein. Now, if it was a fighter he just got, like, you know, it's only the second or third fight with him, then, yeah, perhaps it could be because of confusion. But he's been with Marquez his whole career, so, yeah, I give him the benefit of the doubt here. Even though, like you, I agree. I don't know what he was seeing as well. And the other thing was, you know, he knows Marquez is the end of his career. Maybe he was thinking, you know, maybe hopefully he can talk him out of another fight and get him into retirement and ease him into retirement instead of, you know, telling him to go out there and go out on his shield. That's the only even halfway viable excuse I could give for that advice between rounds. Because like you, I was kind of thinking, you know, what's he doing or why he's doing that? And I don't know if you follow along on Twitter, but my Twitter line was exploding, you know, saying, you know, the second guessing was immediate. Instead of, you know, usually the second guessing is on Monday morning. On Twitter, it is immediate.
Now, Salido, they announced that his first mandatory, who was it? I just went blank. Orlando Salido won the title. His first mandatory he's got to fight. Do you remember who it is?
Yeah, I'm not even sure. I would have to take a look at the ratings. It's not going to be Marquez. The only people I can think of, De Leon, maybe?
No, hold on. I will, I'll be able to remember it, here in a second. Oh no, Gary Russell. Gary Russell. Gary Russell Jr. is the mandatory, and that's an interesting fight. Gary Russell, obviously, this is going to be the toughest fight that he's ever had. I think Gary Russell has the tools to possibly beat Salido, but Salido, I love watching that guy fight. He reminds me of Orlando Cruz, the other Orlando Cruz, the one that we both liked that finally retired. He's that kind of a guy, Orlando Salido.
Yeah, you're thinking of Cristobal.
Oh, Cristobal Cruz. That's right. Cristobal Cruz. I'm sorry.
Yeah, both of you and I, I can't speak highly enough of him as well. Just a guy who does everything well but nothing exceptional, and someone who worked their way to a title. You know, and guys like that are never going to keep the title for a very long time, but, you know, it's almost a rise. You enjoy the rise as much as the title reign. So I'm glad that, you know, Salido got his title shot and won the title, made some money, but I don't see him beating Gary Russell Jr. simply because it's stylistically. I mean, give the match, not the matchmaker, but give the promoter for Gary Russell Jr. credit here. This is the exact type of style that's going to pick Salido apart. I mean, look what Mickey Garcia did. It's all about movement and speed. At this point of his career, Salido cannot handle movement and speed. He needs somebody to stand in front of him, much like like Juan Mar Lopez did. You know, those are the fights that he's going to win. Who was another one? When he beat Cristobal Cruz, they kind of stood in front of each other and just battled it out. But what beat him? Gamboa beat Salido, you know, widely on the scarf because he had the speed, he had the movement. And the other guys, Mickey Garcia, just picked him apart with speed and movement. And I'm afraid, and I'm not a big Gary Russell backer. I see his skills. I appreciate his potential. I just think he's getting pushed onto HBO too quickly, almost like Andre Berto did. But I do think he's better than Berto. But, he's going to beat Salido. He's going to get that title. And hopefully, unlike Andre Berto, he's going to learn more inside the boxing gym to be able to hold that title, because I don't think he's beaten the type of opposition to hold a title for a long time.
This weekend we got a really, there's fights going on, but nothing super great except for one. But before we get to that one, the other Chavez kid, Omar, the businessman Chavez, is taking on Joachim Alsine, which is actually an interesting fight. I'm going to throw at you the old, you know, the old crossroads fight, but it really is. I mean, Chavez is a young fighter. He had a couple of bumps in his young career, and Alsine is you know, at the end of his career. It's an important fight for both of these guys. I'm having a hard time picking a winner in this one. I don't know which Alsine is going to show up, and for that matter, I don't know which Omar Chavez is going to show up. How are you picking this one?
I need to know one thing. Where's the fight being held? Mexico, right?
Of course.
That's where. So that's the direction I'm going to go. Look, Omar Chavez, look, Julio Cesar Chavez Jr., if his name was Billy Joe Smith, he would not be on HBO, and he would not be, you know, rated in the top 10 or the top 20 in his weight class. But because of his name, because he's the son of a legend, he gets not preferential treatment, but he's elevated in people's eyes. They assume that, you know, the bloodline is going to make this guy better. And Omar Chavez has already proven that bloodline does not make him better. And look who he lost to, Jorge Paez Jr. I think he lost to Paez Jr. twice.
Yes, he did. Once. No, I think one might have been a draw. One might have been a draw. Yeah, one. But you could be right. He could have lost both of them. But that's exactly who one of the losses
was. Well, I remember that was his last loss, and I even remember watching that. I think that was on TV Azteca or something like that. And look, he's young. I think body top wise, I think he's the best mix. You know, he's most reminiscent of his father. You know, he has that. He's not a super middleweight. He's a welterweight or a junior middleweight. But what it comes down to is he would not be on TV, and he would not be, you know, anywhere near the status he holds right now in Mexico. As you know, he can get endorsements in Mexico, just like his older brother is, just because of his name. But on pure boxing ability, he's a C-plus guy working his way into B-minus status. And Joachim Alsine, he's a spent force. I don't think he's won any of his last four or five fights. He came up, he had that one, you know, like they say of any old fighter, you know, he has one last good fight in him. He had that fight against David Lemieux, and I think after that, that's it. You know, he pretty much lost his next fight, and I think people see that at age, he's got to be, nearing 40 now? At that age, he's a spent force, but he still has the skill set you want to bring in to test yourself again, because it's a good skill set, it's a good overall skill set, but it's all slow now. So it's coming at you a lot slower. You can decipher it and you can pick it apart because it's just not, it just doesn't have the speed anymore. It just doesn't have the reflexes. And Omar Chavez, even if it goes to the card, which I don't think it will, I think he wins by stoppage in the mid-round.
This fight cracks me up. Now, Manuel Char, a heavyweight that virtually was...
We know because of one reason.
Exactly, and that's exactly what I was going to say. You know, he's virtually unknown fighter. He gets a shot at Klitschko. He's like the, you know, the guy that comes in out of left field. But since then, this guy, every time you turn around, he's, you know, he's fighting this one, fighting that one. Now, he's in a fight against Denis Bakatov. That's not really what I'm going to ask you. What I'm going to ask you is, how do you feel about the new belt that's on the line? The WBC has come up with a belt that's called the WBC CISBB World Belt, and it's for, and I'm not making this up, Marty, it's for boxers who used to fight for the former Soviet Union. What the hell are they coming to? Have you ever heard such a thing?
No, but it's just like our sport almost. It's niche marketing. Now you have a belt for certain regions of the world. I mean, almost like boxing has become a niche sport. You know, it's popular among Hispanics and, you know, men our age, you know, over the 45 mark and stuff like that. It's come down to niche marketing. And if they can make money doing this, obviously, hey, let's say why they're really doing this. There's big money in Russia right now with all that oil capital, natural gas capital. You have more per capita millionaires living in Moscow than any place else in the world. So the money is there. So that's all you need to do in boxing, almost any sport, to tell you the truth, is follow the money. There's money in the Russian and former Soviet Republic. So that's why this belt has been created. They're cashing in on that.
Yeah.
And, you know, Manuel Char, I think his heritage is like Lebanese or something like that.
I know. I don't even know how he's getting it. I know. And the other guy, I don't, maybe because Bakhtov, I don't know. But you know, he's one of these guys that seems, and he's just like the guy I'm going to ask you about next, but he seems like since he was on the stage, the big stage against Klitschko, and since many people actually thought that the fight was stopped prematurely against Klitschko, that he was doing pretty well, that he's actually gotten better. And I, you know, it's almost like you hear the name now and you're like, well, you know, he's that heavyweight that's not that bad, you know. And, you know, how much of it do you think, you know, has to do with that the fact that he's stepped up his game since he got the shot at the title? Marty, I'm losing you, Marty. I got to try and let me try and get you back here. We will try to get Marty back. We are experiencing some issues with the phone system, so I apologize for that. But Marty and I both agree about, you know, certain fighters, and the other fighter I'm going to ask him about after Manuel Char is another one that, you know, once they get their world title, they seem to step it up a notch. Now, Manuel Char never got his world title, but he fought for it. And, you know, he kind of got a moral victory by, you know, performing better than most people thought, and definitely better than I thought, against Klitschko. The other thing about that fight was that, and it's Vitaly, and the other thing about that fight was that many people felt, like I just said to Marty, that the fight was stopped prematurely, that they rushed the TKO on that one, and he wanted to continue, and a lot of other people wanted that fight to continue. And they didn't. They didn't let it. They just waved it off, and it's over, you know. So we'll have to wait and see. But curious to know, you know, if Marty thinks he stepped up his game or not. And we're going to try Marty back here in a second to wrap up the show here. So I will try this one more time, and hopefully we can get Marty back in a second here. But you just have to bear with me as I locate him in the system here, and we'll see if we can't get him back as we speak, or at least I'm trying to get him back as we speak. But anyway, are you there, Marty?
Yes, I am.
Okay, good. We got you. Sorry about that. Now, what were you saying? It sounded like you were swimming.
Yeah, I was just going to say I was just trying to get away you never want to bring up the specter of death in boxing, but let's put it this way. Manuel Char went up against Vitaly Klitschko, and in boxing, that's like facing death. I mean, that's the best opponent he's ever going to face the rest of his career, no matter who comes up. So, I mean, that fight made him better, and it prepares him for anything else in his future. And if you look at it, since losing that fight, I think he's won his next two or three fights. And I know he beat a fighter named Sagram, who's decent, not anything over the top, but he looked really good. And even in the fight against Klitschko, you have to remember that, you know, he was fighting a bad cut as well as the Klitschko. And unlike most Klitschko opponents, after he got knocked down, he got back up and kept trying. And then when he was stopped on his feet. So those are positives you can take away in Char's favor. And like I said, whenever there's two fighters in this generation, there's the Mayweathers and the Klitschkos. Any boxer that has a loss against those three boxers, I don't hold it against them, and I don't count them against them on a record. It's just that you just wipe those away and take the rest of their career, and you focus on that, because I just don't see anybody you know, beating those guys. They're just that much better than the rest of the generation.
Both you and I agree that Robert Stiglitz became a totally different fighter when he won his world title. He subsequently lost it and regained it. He's fighting this weekend. He's fighting a virtually an unknown guy in Isaac Ekpo. Obviously, this is just a stay busy fight. Is it a dangerous fight for Robert Stiglitz, or is this just going to be you know, a wham bam? Thank you, ma'am.
I couldn't tell you, because I have yesterday, in preparation for this, I tried to find footage of Ekpo. There is none. I scanned. I asked people about it. Nobody's gotten back to me. He's never fought outside of Africa, from what I could tell. So, in the amateur ranks, I asked some of my people who follow the amateurs, you know, because Nigeria does have a good amateur reputation. Nobody knows of this guy, so I really can't tell you. Mentally wise, I trust Robert Stieglitz. I think he's coming into this fight 100% prepared mentally, and I think he's done everything that he has in the other fights. You know, did he do the extra sit up? Did he do the extra push up? No, I don't think so. But I think mentally he's prepared, and he's going to go in there and get this win. Because if you look at he beat a Japanese opponent right after the Arthur Abraham fight. You know, he got into the ring pretty quickly afterwards, like 2-3 months after that win. And I like champions who stay busy, you know, between the big fights. So yeah, I'm giving him more credit than this and seeing this as a potential hazard. And if he did see it as a potential hazard, if he was not, you know, at least 90% ready, you know, he would have had the old back injury to get out of it.
And finally, the biggest fight of the weekend, which is, incidentally, are you going to the, how far are you from Denver?
Oh, I'm only 45 minutes away from where the fight's going to be.
Are you
going to go up there? But and I got myself a press pass, but I'm not going to be working. I just got myself a press pass to go shake a couple of hands, meet a couple of people and stuff like that. But I bought tickets to the event. I believe in, you know, when an event comes to your area, support it as a boxing fan. So I did a little bit of both. You know, me and my wife are going to go. I'm going to sit in the stands for the main event, try to catch Juan Diaz on the undercard and stuff like that. And so it's a little bit of both, a little bit of business, and mostly pleasure.
Well, I tell you what, it's the worst undercard I've ever seen. You know?
Oh, it is absolutely horrible. I mentioned Juan Diaz, and that's about it.
Yeah, well, yeah, you mentioned him, and it, even he's not fighting a live body. But
well, no, he's not. But, I mean, Juan Diaz, plus he's just such a he's a really good person on top of it. So he's the type of person you want to meet outside of the ring as well. Because, you know, he gets his law degree. He wants to help people outside of the, you know, outside of the ring. He wants to become just as famous as he was inside the ring.
Yeah, no, I've met him, and he usually travels with his parents and stuff. And he's exciting to watch. But the main event is going to be an exciting event. We know that. If you know, if you had a dollar to gamble, you bet that this is going to be a good fight. Mike Alvarado against Ruslan Pradagnikov. The way I'm seeing this fight, Marty, is I think Mike Alvarado is going to basically go back to the future. He's going to go back to the second Bam Bam Rios fight and try to outbox Pradagnikov. I think that's what his game plan going into the fight is. The only problem is that Mike Alvarado has a tendency, like Timothy Bradley and like Manny Pacquiao, to oblige if an opponent wants to stand there and trade with him. And I think that's what Pradagnikov's going to do. Pradagnikov's not a boxer. He never claims to be. He has no defense. He wants to fight in a phone booth. How's this fight going to go, and who's going to win?
Yeah, I think you can look back and take a little bit of the Brandon Rios fight, take a little bit of the Bradis Prescott fight. That's what it's going to be like. I expect this to be a rock'em sock'em fight after the first four rounds are over. In the first three rounds, I think Alvarado's going to try to box, and I think Pravatnikov is going to see what Alvarado has as far as lateral movement. Can he cut it off? You know, what does he have to do to get his game plan going? And Alvarado, when he's moving laterally and shooting those shots out, he's a pretty accurate puncher. And I think he can, if it were skill-based alone, I think Alvarado wins this fight. But Pravatnikov, I think, is really underrated as far as maintaining distance. Bradley, as he showed against Juan Marquez, is the type of guy that it's hard to get close to and be effective. And Pravatnikov showed, you know, during large portions of the fight that he can, when he gets in there, he has the power to hurt him. And I might have to go into disguise up there after this, but I think Pravatnikov is going to escape that fight with the belt. Simply because of what you said, Alvarado, when he gets hit too much, he almost looks to take the easy way out by standing and trading, because it is harder on your legs, on your stamina, you know, to box your way out of trouble than to slug your way out of trouble. And I think once Alvarado is slowed down by Pravatnikov, once they're on even levels and it comes down to just power, Pravatnikov is just a steamroller kind of guy. And if you look at the Bradis Prescott fight and the first Brandon Rios fight, Alvarado fades down the stretch. Pravatnikov gets stronger down the stretch. So I think those two things are going to come into effect in about the 10th, 11th, 12th round. You're going to see a knockdown or two, and if that doesn't swing the fight as far as a stoppage, I think it'll swing the fight in Pravatnikov's way as far as the scorecards. If the scorecards are reasonable, because you're going to have some judges, I think, here, some local Colorado judges, who just are not up to snuff as far as seeing world-class material, because we have not had a world title fight in Denver since Stevie Johnson back in the early 2000s.
Let me ask you.
That's my main concern.
Let me ask you one more question, and we'll let you go. Prudognikov, do you think he punches harder than Bam Bam Rios?
Not for one punch, no. But I think he puts his punches together than Brandon Rios. And remember with Brandon Rios, he got this punch reputation at lightweight and junior lightweight when, you know, he's one of those guys like Gotti who could shrink his body down and come back and weigh 15, 20 pounds more on fight night than he did at the weigh-in, and that really helped him in a lot of those fights. If you look at those fights against, I forget, the Kevin Mitchell, I think, was the Englishman who came over and stuff like that, where he really wore him down. He doesn't score, you know, first, second, third round knockouts. Brandon Rios is the guy who scores the you know, over the stretch stoppages.
Yeah, you know, I met Prudognikov after his fight with Bradley, and he's a small guy. He's a small guy, and you know, he looks bigger on TV. That's for sure.
Yeah, he's more of a I went up to the training camp up there, and he's a thick guy. I mean, if you look across the chest, that's where his weight was. Remember, Thomas Hearns was the type of guy, all of his weight was like between his neck and his and where his abs started. You know, he had those big, broad shoulders. And it's a little bit the same with Prudognikov. If you look at his body type, all of his musculature is really in his chest. And that's where you see where he can really put the force into it is when he gets on the inside. He doesn't need that big turning radius because he does have his heft there, and that's where a lot of his weight and, you know, weight equals force.
Marty, I appreciate your time, and I'm glad we hung up on you and got you back real quick. And we'll look forward to you next week. Enjoy the fights. I'm glad you're going to be there live. That's cool. And I hope you have a good time. I hope that the undercard is at least entertaining for you and your wife when you go there. And, hey, man, it's good to have boxing local, right?
Yeah, hey, and you keep a little lookout around the ringside. I'll be wearing my Black Billy C boxing shirt, so maybe you get some free advertisement.
Sounds good, man. I'll definitely be looking for you, bro.
All right, everybody have a great weekend.
All right, Marty, thanks a lot. That's the man, the myth, the legend himself, Marty Mulcahy, joining us the way he always does on Thursdays. And we stick around a little extra longer just to accommodate Marty, because Marty's such an important part of this show. So anyway, that was Marty's take on what was going on with those fights. Hey, man, that concludes our show for today. I'm glad you stuck around a little longer. Oh, yeah, I got one more thing to say. Make sure you tune in tomorrow evening, same bat time, same bat channel. Until then, ciao, baby.